So welcome to the last session of UNIF. We start the session with a talk by Richard Waldinger with the title, What Again? This of the unification algorithm. Please, Richard.
Hello, this is a talk about program synthesis, which is the automatic design or derivation of algorithms. And in this case, we're focusing on the unification algorithm. In deductive program synthesis, we use deductive methods, theorem-proving methods. And we start with a logical specification of the program we're interested in, which doesn't give any hint of the algorithm to be used. It just states the purposes of the program. We take this specification and phrase it as a theorem in a logical system. We submit the theorem to an automatic theorem prover. The theorem is proved automatically, and the proof is restricted to be sufficiently constructive so that a program can be extracted. And our work on unification is work in progress. It's not yet complete. So in program synthesis, we start with a specification which says that for every input E, there exists an output Z, such that Q holds between E and Z, or Z. The corresponding theorem says that for every input E, there exists an output Z, which satisfies this input-output relation Q. The proof is restricted to be sufficiently constructive so that we can extract a program from it. And the proof is conducted in a subject domain theory, an axiomatic theory that describes the constructs in our programming language and the necessary background knowledge. And the structure of the program we extract from the proof reflects the structure of the proof itself. So if the proof uses a case analysis, the program will have a conditional construct, if then else, for instance. If the proof is by mathematical induction, the program will imply, use recursion. Now, the theorems that we have to prove are typically difficult for automatic theorem provers. First of all, they use full quantification, of course, universal and existential. They rely on case analysis. So for instance, resolution theorem provers are not particularly good at case analysis. It gives them trouble. And also our proofs are by mathematical induction, which typically don't fit within a first order logic framework. So usually you have to go to higher order logic to do induction. And finally, our proofs have to be restricted to allow program construction. Now, the unification algorithm, which is, I think, familiar to everyone here, it was implicit in the work of Erbrand in 1930, I believe, and was made more explicit by Alan Robinson in his influential paper on the resolution principle. And unification was an early target of automatic program synthesis efforts. I had a paper with Zohar Monnet from 1981, which carried out a full synthesis, but it was completely manual. There was nothing automatic about it. Larry Paulson did an interactive verification of the same algorithm, but it was interactive. So he directed it was a verification. So he started knowing the program and constructed a proof that established its correctness. But as far, and there have been many papers on it which give partial syntheses from the Alan Bundy group using induction. They're in logic programming frameworks, but as far as I know, no completely automatic synthesis has been completed, going from specification to program. And a lot of our work towards automating this has been finding a formulation of the theory which is conducive to automatic theorem proving. Now, the Robinson paper said that the unification algorithm found a most general unifier, but he never actually defined more general what the more general relation was. So in our paper with Mana, we use this definition, which is fairly clearly what Robinson had in mind. One substitution is more general than another if you can get from the first to the second by composition with some substitution, where diamond represents the substitution composition operation. So we started with this specification. For input expressions E1 and E2, we try to find a substitution theta, which is, first of all, it must be a unifier of E1 and E2. And second of all, it must be most general in the sense that if there's any other unifier, the one we come up with is at least as general as the one as this other unifier. And this is in the positive case in which the E1 and E2 are unifiable. In the negative case, we said that in this case, the algorithm should return a special symbol bottom or fail, which means that the expressions are not unifiable. In our current work, we're limiting ourselves to expressions which are S expressions. In other words, they have only a single function symbol cons. But this is not a substantive limitation. We can encode any first order terms as S expressions, and having just one function symbol doesn't make it essential. It's simpler, but not essentially simpler. So in doing our proof, this was true in our paper with Mana also, we find, we confront the what Polya called the inventor's paradox, which says that we must, in trying to prove a theorem, sometimes it's easier to prove a harder theorem. And in particular, in a proof by mathematical induction, it can be easier to prove a harder or more general theorem, because then we get the benefit of a stronger induction hypothesis, a more general induction hypothesis. For program synthesis, if we can start with a stronger specification or more general specification, we get the benefit of stronger recursive calls. So in the unification case, we found it advantageous to include in the specification the additional condition that the unifier we find be idempotent. In other words, applying it twice has exactly the same effect as applying it once. And this is equivalent to saying that no variable appears on the left and the right-hand side of any arrow in the substitution. So we actually proved the stronger theorem, which says not only is theta a most general unifier, but also it's idempotent. But in our current work in automating the derivation, we found it advantageous to use an even stronger generality relation, which we could call the idempotent generality relation. So we say a substitution is idempotently more general than another if you can get from the first one to the second by composition with the second one itself. So instead of having an arbitrary substitution here, we have exactly the same, the right-hand substitution is our bridge substitution between the two. And this turns out to be equivalent to the original most general generality relation in the case in which theta is idempotent. And also, we can establish that if a substitution is idempotently more general than itself, then it is itself idempotent. So it's a equivalent definition of idempotence. So we began working on this stronger specification. Well, it's equivalent, but using the stronger relation, the idempotent most generality relation. And this turns out to imply that the substitution we find is idempotent. A further simplification to the specification was found by defining, regarding this failure object as an improper substitution. And this is defined to have the effect that applying it to any expression at all yields a specific constant called the black hole. So in this case, the failure substitution is a kind of unifier for all expressions. But we don't take those expressions, we don't regard them as unifiable, because this is not a proper substitution. It's an improper substitution. So the specification we work with is the very simple specification that theta b a unifier, and theta b indefinitely most general. And so in this case, the case in which these are not unifiable is implied by this specification, because the failure substitution is the only substitution that can unify these expressions if they're actually not unifiable. So in our experimental work, this is trying to get a theorem prover to carry out the derivation itself. We use the theorem prover SNARK, which was implemented by Mark Stickel in the last century. This is a fairly conventional resolution paramodulation theorem prover. I won't talk about the induction here, but we use well-founded induction, induction over a well-founded relation. And this would normally be a higher order concept, but we finesse the induction by reifying the well-founded relation. So we actually do it in a first order setting. And we have SNARK is particularly good at program extraction. I don't believe any theorem prover has the strong enough program extraction to do this derivation. I'd be happy to be proved wrong. So I won't show the entire program, but in the recursive case in which the two arguments are both conses, the algorithm we found was simpler than the one we had expected to find. So this is the algorithm that for this case was constructed automatically by SNARK. What it does is it tries to unify the left-hand sides of the two expressions. If it's produces this unifier theta 1, which can be empty or could be a proper substitution. We then apply this substitution to the right-hand sides and try to unify them, getting another substitution theta 2. We then take the composition of theta 1 and theta 2, and this can be proved to be a most general unifier for the two expressions. And this is actually simpler than the one we found in Mann and Waldinger, because that one we regarded the non-unifiable case as a special case. So we would always have a case analysis here, our C1 and C2. Is this empty or is this not empty? And this one, is this empty or not empty? But this is now covered by regarding bottom as being an improper substitution, which we can compose like any other substitution. Now, this is still an expensive program. It requires applying a substitution to an expression, which could be an expensive operation because you have to go through the whole expression looking for replacements. And also, it requires doing the composition of two substitutions, which is also expensive. And this kind of algorithm is generally not used in resolution theorem proofs for this reason. The we were asked at when we presented this at LPOP, the a logic programming workshop, we were asked whether it was possible to get a more efficient algorithm. And for this purpose, we needed to generalize the specification further. We, instead of just unifying two expressions, we unify them in the context of some initial idempotent substitution theta zero. So we require not only that the substitution we find be a unifier, we require it must be an extension of the initial substitution, and it must be idempotently more general than any other unification, any other substitution which is an extension of the initial substitution. So it must we only need to consider other unifiers that are extensions of our initial substitution. And this is a generalization because in the case in which theta zero is the empty substitution which does nothing, this specification reduces to a previous specification. But it's more general, and theta zero gets to be used as an accumulator. It's like a temporary variable in the algorithm. It keeps track of the unifiers we found so far, and it's not a new idea. It's often used in program transformation or used in translating recursive to iterative algorithms. And in this case, Snark again found an algorithm which was simpler than we expected, at least in the recursive case. What the algorithm does, it, you know, in the context of the initial substitution theta zero, it unifies the left-hand sides. And then it yields a new, possibly improper substitution. And it takes this to be the initial substitution for the second recursive call, which attempts to unify the right-hand side. So there's no composition. There's no applying a substitution to an expression. We just give this the unification that we found so far as an auxiliary, as an initial argument for the second recursive call. So this gave us actually a simpler proof as well as a faster and simpler program. So at this stage, I know sometimes people give motivation at the beginning, but I'd like to defer it to the end. This, of course, is useful as an exercise in program synthesis. It's a simple program, but it's fairly challenging for program synthesis. It's an open problem. There's a possibility that we may discover new and better unification algorithms, although so far we haven't we don't compete with the fast unification algorithms like Montanari. But we could also entertain the possibility of developing special unification algorithms for special theories. Like in the previous talk, there were special unification algorithms applied to cryptographic problems. We could think of doing special unification algorithms that could be generated when we're faced with a new theory. We could first of all try to generate a unification algorithm for that theory, which would allow us to eliminate some of the axioms, just like associative commutative unification lets us eliminate the associativity and commutativity axioms, and it makes the proofs more efficient. That would be a challenging thing to derive, but there are simpler algorithms for, like, the theory of substitutions and expressions itself might be a case in which we could generate a unification algorithm which would let the derivation of other unification algorithms go more quickly. And anyway, that's my time. So let me take questions or have discussion if there is any.
So thanks a lot. You were exactly on time. Are there any questions? So
If there is a little time, I do have a example of the program.
If no one else has a question, I would have one.
Oh, sure. This is the snark proof that led to the recursive case, but I wasn't going to explain it. Anyway, go ahead.
So you mentioned unification algorithms for special theories. So what, say you want to do a unification algorithm where some of your symbols are commutative.
Yes.
What would you need to do? Would you just add somehow a commutativity axiom to your specification?
Yes, exactly. You'd add. I must say I haven't done this, so I would have to try to do it. But we would try to add that to the theory. Like now our only function symbol is const, which is not commutative. But if we had some other function symbol that was commutative, we would add that commutativity as an axiom to the theory.
Yeah, but I mean, the problem, for example, with commutativity would be that then you don't have a most general unifier anymore. You have what we call a complete set of unifiers, but which consists of several unifiers. So somehow,
even in the first order case, there may be many different unifiers, even in the non-commutative case.
But one is enough. I mean, in the commutative case, there for quite a lot of these problems, there doesn't exist a most general unifier.
Yeah.
Because you need several unifiers to cover all of them. Yeah.
Then we would have to modify the specification to talk about a complete set of unifiers.
Yes.
Yeah, so we couldn't just take this and carry it over to we couldn't just add the commutativity axiom. We would have to also change the specification. That's true.
Right. And so you mentioned that the algorithm you got was more efficient than the one you had before.
Yes.
But I assume it is still exponential because it works on terms and not on tags.
Yes. I mean, getting a more efficient algorithm would also be a research problem, an extension of the work we've done so far. But so far, we haven't completely done the proof of for this exponential algorithm. And I don't think we believe anyone else has.
So I actually have to leave this room and go to the backstage of the next one because we will, in a minute or so, we will start the next thing. I mean, if you want to show something else, you can show it, but it will be seen only for 1.5 minutes.
Okay, I don't really need to show this proof. It was just to display it.
I think I just thank you again for this very nice talk and I'll move to the next one.
Okay, thank you.